Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship. Before we begin worship, we have another sad announcement. We've just had a sad couple of weeks in our church. Denise's mom, Doris, passed away earlier this week, so we hold their whole family in our prayers. We made it back from the mission trip, and things went well, so thank you for your prayers. Unfortunately, part of what happened on the way back is our group, and especially me, got exposed to COVID. So I'm being very careful today, I'm not going to be serving communion. So we'll have communion, but others are going to serve it. And I can tell you all about it. Kenny, your home area is beautiful.
Thank you very much.
It is gorgeous, but it's very hard to drive in.
Yes, it is.
We will begin with an order of confession and forgiveness. Please rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those who need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life, save us from ourselves, and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves. In our gathering song is number 765.
Thank you.
together. Let us pray. Benevolent God, you are the source, the guide, and the goal of our lives. Teach us to love what is worth loving, to reject what is offensive to you, and to treasure what is precious in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. And kids, you can stay where you are, or if you want to see a little better, if you want to come to like that second pew right there. But if you want, you can stay where you are. So today, I want to talk about food. Do you think, raise your hand if you think there is not enough food for every person on earth. Raise your hand if you think there is enough food for every person on earth. Is that James thinks that there is?
James.
Well, James is right. There is enough food for every person on earth. But a lot of people are hungry. So this is some rice. I'm going to put this in here. Let's say that you need to eat 5 pieces of rice a day. We pretend you have really tiny people. And there are 3 people that are going to share this. Are they going to have enough rice for a week? Yeah, they're definitely going to have enough rice for the week. They're going to be able to have more if they want. They can eat as much as they want. Now let's say, I'm going to put a little bit more in there. I'm just like rounding it up. Okay. Let's say same thing. You need 5 pieces of rice to have enough to eat, and 3 people have to share this. Will they have enough for a week, do you think? Brooks, do you think they will? Do you want to see how, like, what it looks like? So if they needed, 3 people needed 5 pieces of rice a day, do you think they'd have enough for a week? You think they would? I think it would probably be pretty darn close, but I think they probably would. Now let's say 3 people had to share this, and they needed 5 pieces of rice a day for a week. Sammy, do you think there would be enough? No, there wouldn't be enough. Well, these cups are kind of like different areas in the world. And there are some areas of the world, like the United States, where we have so much food. You know, when you go to the grocery store, next time you go to the grocery store, I want you to stand in the middle of the aisle, the cereal aisle, and I want you to look down and realize that you're being surrounded by 2 great big walls of food. And that cereal is going to be there, and anybody that has the money to buy it, and not everybody does, but everybody that has the money to buy it can go and get that cereal. And in some other places, they have enough, but they don't have a lot of extra. And in some places, they don't have enough. How could we make sure that everybody has enough? What do you think, Brooks? Share it. So now we definitely, that is a little bit, but definitely everybody in the whole world could have what they needed. But there's a lot of things that get in the way from people getting that food that they need. And I want to tell you about something that we're going to be doing, us kids, families, and anyone else who wants to join us in October. We're going to do something called the Crop Walk. And we are going to go to Williams Bay and walk. And we're going to tell people, hey, I'm walking the Crop Walk. Do you want to give me a little bit of money so that I can share that money with people who are helping people who are hungry? And your friends and your family can give you some money, and then you're going to walk. And it's a walk to remember those who are hungry. And all the money goes to different groups of people that
that work hard to make sure that we can share and make sure that the whole world can have food, because God made the world that way. And God made us to be able to figure out how everybody can get enough. And so just wanted to tell you about that. I hope you can walk the crop walk with us. Thank you. We'll continue with the readings.
And that renewal There is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave and free, but Christ is all and in all. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the gospel. But he said to him, "Friend, who set me to be a judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly. And he thought to himself, "What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, drink, eat, be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. In the things you have prepared, whose will they be?' So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich towards God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. I invite you to turn your Bibles, if you would like to. I know the print is a little bit small, but if you'd like to follow along, go ahead and turn your Bibles to Luke 12, starting at verse 13. So Luke chapter 12, and if you remember, Luke is in the New Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. It says in the bulletin what page. It's page 951. So page 951 is where you can find it. So I want you to start out, as you're looking that up, I want you to start out by thinking about if you had a chance to talk to Jesus, to be face-to-face with Jesus, and ask him a question or have a conversation, what would it be about? I think that would be just an unimaginable, profound, powerful experience to be able, as a human being, to talk to Jesus. Well, there was someone who had that opportunity. And you can see in verse 13 what he used it for. He wanted Jesus to settle a fight over money with his brother. I just don't really think that's the best use of a conversation with Jesus. So verse 13, he says, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." When I noticed that this week, I was thinking about just like 2 weeks ago, we had Mary and Martha. And Martha, she did the same thing that this person does. She says, "Jesus, tell my sister to do this." And Jesus has nothing to do with it. I think that says a lot to us because often we can get kind of judgmental. And I think sometimes we use our conversations with Jesus to talk about other people, to bring Jesus into these squabbles and these different things that we're having. And we can pray about anything. But I think it's just really interesting that Jesus doesn't take this very far with Martha or with this man. So verse 14, Jesus doesn't want to have anything to do with it. He says, "You know what, friend? I'm not your judge. I'm not your arbitrator, but I'll tell you a story." And so then verse 16, The land of a rich man produced abundantly. So that's how it starts. So right away we know that this person is rich, and we know that his land produced abundantly. Now, who caused that land to produce abundantly? Who fired up the sun? Who made the rain to fall? Who designed the seed? Who made the soil? It was the Creator. So because of God's abundance, this man's field, who's already rich, he had a really good year, it produced abundantly. And so that happened, and he thought to himself. So notice he's not talking to anybody else. Maybe he has a wife, but we don't hear about it. Maybe he's got a neighbor that he's friends with, but we don't hear about it. It sounds like he really just has himself. And he has a conversation with himself about what to do with the blessings that God has given him. So what should I do? For I have no place to store my crops. We just saw something that you could do, right? That's a great way to solve the problem of having too much, is to pour your cup into somebody else's. But he's not thinking like that at all. Then he said, I will do this. This is his plan. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I think this next part is really sad. So he's still having a conversation with himself. Now he's having a conversation with his soul. Just like if you were going to have a conversation with Jesus, what would you talk about? Hopefully not asking Jesus to be a judge against somebody else. And now he's got this conversation going on with his soul. And this is what he talks to his soul about. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry. I feel like that's a conversation you would have with your financial advisor, not with your soul. But so many of us, we don't have great conversations with our soul. But our soul is that part of us that, if our soul is well, it connects to other people. It desires God. It calls us to live lives that are abundant in love and relationships, but something is just not right with this man's soul. And so he's got this plan, and he's really excited about it, but he doesn't know that that night he's going to unexpectedly die. Verse 20, but God said to him, you fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God. You know, this week, last couple of weeks of having our dear members pass away, and thinking about their lives, and even reading their obituaries, and all of the things that they did to share and give, and seeing the love of their families, and everything that they have left behind, it kind of reminds me of this story, but it's sort of like the opposite ending. Their lives are continuing on in this church, in the love of their families, in the line of this love. I mean, it's just the work that they did is continuing on, and it's so inspiring, and it's a reminder that we don't live forever. We are dust, and to dust we shall return. In this last verse, I think it's a real invitation for us to imagine. Verse 21, this is what Jesus says. So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God. I think you've probably already heard that saying that you can't pull a trailer behind a hearse with all your stuff, right? So the stuff is not important. But being rich toward God causes our lives to be eternal, being rich toward God. I want you to think about the ways right now that your life is already rich toward God. Your relationships, your joys, the things that you love to do, the ways that you help others, the people in your family that you value, the gifts that you have. I just want you to think about it for a minute. How is your life already enriched toward God? And now I want you to imagine that your life could even be more rich toward God. And I want you to think about some different ways that you could be rich toward God, that you could share your soul and the things that you love and care for the people around you. I want you to take a moment and imagine maybe one or two ways that your life could be even more rich toward God. A couple of weeks ago, I came across in a book an exercise that the author invited the reader to do, and it was to write your own obituary. And it's sort of a different idea than what were your accomplishments in life. It's kind of thinking about, in some ways, kind of like a richness toward God. And I just want to think about, I think we could all think about, if we wanted to write our own obituaries, what would we like them to sound like? These are the questions that this author poses. Who did she love? Write about the people, places, animals you love most. What made her come alive? Describe just one scene where you are doing what you most love to do. What did she stand for? What do you do or would you like to do to support, create, inspire change in the world? Her greatest sorrow was. What do you ache for? Write about your mistakes and losses, as well as the heartbreaking, maddening shortcomings of humanity in general. They really like these questions. What color would she like to be remembered by? What song? What smell? What taste? Who was she really all along? The answers to all of those questions tell us different ways that we are rich toward God. Possessions don't bless us very long or very much, but all of these riches of God do, and anything that is in Christ is forever. Jesus invites us to remember that we are dust, and to dust we shall return, but that all these ways that we are rich toward God are lasting and beautiful, and bless the others that we leave behind and are a part of Jesus' death and resurrection. We're invited to be rich toward God, who has certainly been rich toward us in creating a beautiful earth, in giving us people to love, and most of all, by giving us Jesus. We are invited to be rich toward God, who is every day rich toward us. Amen. Please rise for the hymn.
The numbers are reversed on the board. 6, 7, 8 should be next.
Thank you.
Sorry about that.
Thank you.
We continue with the Apostles' Creed. Let us confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
In Christ's presence there is fullness of joy. Come to the banquet.
Thank you.
please rise.
May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. And we pray, life-giving God, through this meal you have bandaged our wounds and fed us with your mercy. Now send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. And receive this blessing. The God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you, comfort you, and show you the path of life, this day and always. Amen. And our sending hymn is number 774. Don't look at the number on the board. It is 774.
Happy anniversary.
14. That's getting good. All right. So happy birthday, Mary.
Teaching and sharing God's love.